talk to you a little bit about kosher and kosher certification, specifically of honey. So, like I said, what I do during the day is I work for, it's actually a family organization started by my dad in the 1960s, a company called the Cuff K, and what we do is we certify food as kosher. So what my goal today is to make everybody in this room a kosher certification expert, and you'll walk away with a clear understanding of what kosher certification is.
Tell me what you
mean. Oh, you're a bit. Okay, go ahead. We're ready for slide number two. Okay, that is it. That's not a picture of me. But what we wanted to talk about was some of, I wanted to comment, we could ask people, I don't know this room included, but generally ask people, what does it mean to be kosher? I actually just came from a facility, a matzah facility, a couple hours ago, but just came. And we're there with a whole bunch of technicians trying to work out the equipment. And the guy said to me, well, Rabbi, as soon as you finish, you do this, and then you're able to bless the food. It's a common misconception that kosher certification has something to do with blessing food, making food blessed, and doing something like that. It really has absolutely nothing to do with that. You can hit that. I think it actually breaks something down. Rabbi blesses the food. That's false. Push to the next, all right? Okay. Kosher doesn't refer to the style of food. Most people think of kosher, they think of matzo balls. They think of knishes and food like that. That's ethnic food. Certainly there are a lot of food, just like there's Italian food and Chinese food. Is definitely, you can go to a kosher deli and you can get your pastrami on rye. That is kosher style. Very often confused, and it was a big question that Jersey was one of the first states to weigh in on. Can I have something labeled as kosher that's not kosher? What does that mean? Kosher dill pickles. Can a company produce kosher dill pickles, which is actually a style of kosher, not kosher? And originally they said no, it was actually challenged, then they said that's just a term that refers to salt, or kosher dill pickles, which is a style and not necessarily representative of kosher. We can go on to that. So what does kosher mean? Kosher, by definition, is actually the word for fit. Kosher means correct. I remember there was once an advertisement for I think it was Hormel. And they said, something's not kosher in the pork business. Caught a lot of attention. That's actually correct. That term's actually correct. I could say something's not kosher. I could look at a piece of equipment, I could look at this table, and I could say, sitting crooked at this table's not kosher, because it means it's not correct and fit. And for kosher, well, there's things that qualify for kosher consumption of food. There's things that qualify as fit and not fit. But in our case, since we're talking about kosher and food, kosher means maybe it satisfies Jewish dietary laws. We can go on to the next slide. By the way, what time am I supposed to finish?
10:30.
No. What time am I supposed to get done?
We take a break at
8:00.
You want me to be done by 8?
No.
So you know what I think I'm going to try to do? I think I'm going to try to get done by 8 with our slides, and then if I have questions, we'll take questions after that. Okay. So, if we go on to the next slide, because this is actually an adorable picture, actually originally clipped by my dad. I colorized it, but he took it. Two pigs talking to each other and said, I wish the whole world kept kosher. From my perspective, certainly, because if the world didn't keep kosher, if nobody kept kosher, I wouldn't have any business. And my wife would be pretty pissed off. But I could always fall back on honey. But anyway, kosher is obviously the other thing people know is there's things that are not kosher, and that's okay, which we sort of touched on in the Hormel story. Let's go on to the next screen. Okay, so kosher food is. Food is kosher only if it conforms with Jewish dietary law. Now, it sounds very complicated. For me to become a rabbi, I had to learn volumes and volumes of laws, many of them related to kosher certification. However, it can really be broken down into two parts. We'll go to the next slide. Kosher certification has... So this is actually a break. This is out of order. Who's interested in kosher? Which is important for people to understand. Kosher has gone way further than just kosher. Hebrew National did a wonderful advertising campaign pushing that. We answer to a higher authority. I don't know if anybody remembers that. But kosher has appeal, and I very often I'll get calls from people in my office that are asking me kosher questions, and I can just tell from the questions that these are not people that themselves are Jewish, and really, as a whole, do not necessarily conform to kosher. But kosher has taken on an understanding that there's another set of eyes, there's somebody else watching and checking kosher certification. And who could that be that are looking for? Jews, obviously. Not all Jews keep kosher. There are many Jewish people that do not keep kosher, but the Jewish people that are kosher consuming, and there are various levels of how strict people are. But kosher, many, many Muslims will rely on, they are looking for halal, not kosher, but our laws are very similar, not exact, but very, very similar. They also need honey. So Muslims that will fall into that, and Hindus, Seventh-day Adventists, that's on a religious side. Dietary restrictions, vegetarians, people with food sensitivity will very often get a cold. They're looking for something, we'll get to that, something that doesn't contain any dairy, because we have restrictions on the consumption of dairy together with meat. So we'll very often get people who have lactose problems, vegetarians, vegans, although they won't eat honey. We'll see that one out. And people who are looking for dietary reasons. Obviously, they're not looking for things like sodium and whatnot, because we don't certify for sodium levels and stuff like that, but things that will correspond with kosher requirements. And lastly, take a look in the mirror. There are people who very often will say, I'm comfortable to know that there's an outside agency besides the government who are looking to make sure that they're operating within certain good manufacturing process. Now, does that cross the board? Not necessarily. There's plenty of Jewish, there's something called schmatz, which is chicken fat. Nothing healthy about that. It's not that something is kosher, it's necessarily healthy, but there are many restrictions that are kosher restrictions, which lend itself to making certain foods more healthy and better for us. So we can go on to the next thing. Okay, reasons for buying kosher. It's the Mintel Group. The Mintel Group does studies, independent studies. Unfortunately, every year they come out with wonderful studies showing me some of the advances that have been made in the kosher industry. So reasons for buying kosher. So there's quality, healthiness, food safety, halal dietary. What's interesting is they're showing that this, I don't know that I necessarily buy into this study completely. They're showing that it's only 15% of the people who are buying kosher. That means that there's a whole bunch of people who are purchasing kosher products because they want it to be kosher, but are not necessarily Jewish. So I'm not really convinced that those numbers are exactly right. It's a study. Studies can be somewhat erroneous. But certainly it shows that there's a big, huge factor of people who are saying it's got a kosher mark on it, it is considered better quality. I will tell you that many of the companies that we deal with have that attitude. Unilever said to us, we spend more money on kosher through the processing than we believe it's worth by itself, but we feel that it promotes our product as a more healthy, and that there's somebody else that can over our shoulder. We're getting to the stuff related to us. So basics of kosher. Permitted and prohibited food sources, we're going to get to that in a second. Separation of milk and meat, we do not eat milk and meat together, which I'll get to also. And separation of kosher and non-kosher. If you meet these three requirements, that's all there is to kosher. Basically kosher in these three things. We get these three things kosher, we're going to get the honey soon. You're going to cover all of these areas. We'll go to the next slide. Okay, kosher permits. And for an animal to be kosher, think carefully about our honeybee because it's not going to fall into that category. The animal has to have split hooves and chewed cut. Those are animals. Next would be fish. Fish have to have fins and scales. All unprocessed grains, beans, fruits, and vegetables. Then birds are a little bit confusing. The Bible lists the birds that are non-kosher. There's only a small list. We, however, only eat birds that we know and can confirm are not members of those of that list, because that list we have forgotten. We do not know exactly which birds are on this list. Chickens, turkey, pheasants, a couple of other birds, ducks, our geese that list there are kosher. We can go over to the next slide. I think it might list there. Prohibited. Okay. What it didn't say is there actually didn't talk about insects at all. Are insects kosher? So the knee-jerk reaction says absolutely not. That's actually wrong. There are certain locusts that are kosher. I've never eaten a locust in my life, nor am I really running out to the store to buy locust and flour. Although that's the up-and-coming protein now is cricket flour, which has become a little bit of a problem in our industry. Sounds pretty gross to me too. But there are certain locusts that are kosher. The Ethiopians and the Yemenite Jews actually regularly do part of their diet. I trained under a Yemenite Jew in Israel, part of my training, when I was learning about, actually when I learned circumcision, I studied under a Yemenite Jew, and he actually sort of on his rooftop, raised locusts that he actually, on rare occasion, consumed. But for the most part, all other insects, other than this one individual group of locusts, are considered non-kosher. So we're going to have to deal with our honeybee in a little bit. But if you can click on that, it's going to drop down shellfish, swan, sea animals, a whole list of non-kosher rodents, insects. These are the questions. Okay, we'll move to the next one. So, the next thing you have to consider is when somebody goes, when I go to the store and I look to buy kosher, so that was really simple. I stay away from insects, I stay away from any pork, but there, the truth is there are sometimes foods that I go as a kosher consumer and I go to buy that I'm going to be looking to avoid that are not necessarily blatantly out there. I'm obviously not going to have the bacon, although that was a real challenge because I have to beat my bear fence with bacon. It's not every day that a rabbi goes into a store. and I actually have one in my refrigerator with a big sign in it, not kosher. Gelatin is an interesting thing. There is actually kosher gelatin available. It's actually made from fish, but gelatin is something that's not great. Omega-3 or vitamins can sometimes have non kosher on it. Castoreum is a derivative of beaver, believe it or not. And carmine is made from insects. As is a couple of other things, but carmine is a good example, because we're going to have to deal with that. Carmine is non-kosher. It's a red color, and it's non-kosher. So carmine's non-kosher, we're going to have to deal with why honey would be kosher. We go over to the next slide. Okay, and then there's, now we've got our statuses. I was telling you about, according to kosher law, it's actually it's written in the Bible. The Bible writes that thou shalt not cook a kid in its mother's milk. We don't necessarily take that literally, that it just means a kid and its mother's milk. It means milk and meat. We don't eat milk and meat together. I will not have a cheeseburger. I also, after I eat meat, I will wait 6 hours before I eat dairy. I am absolutely addicted to coffee. Because of that, come hell or high water, I will never eat meat other than at night. So if they invite me to a party and they've got delicious deli sandwiches and I love deli, I will not touch it because I'm going to be able to have coffee afterwards. And I have to wait, my family tradition is 6 hours. I have to wait 6 hours after I eat a meat sandwich, and I'm not going 6 hours during the day without a cup of coffee. So I actually avoid meat entirely, other than the evenings. But we break into three categories. We've got our dairy category, our meat category, and our last category, parm. Parm is the Hebrew word for neutral. Parm means it doesn't contain meat and it doesn't contain dairy. Now, this is sort of a trick question, but something that exits from a product itself, you think would take on the category of that product. So, bees produce honey. Let's even say bees would be kosher. They should fall into the category of meat, and what they produce should actually also be the honey at best case scenario. I shouldn't be able to have that before my coffee. Which is really, if you think about it, not true, because where does milk come from? Milk comes from a cow, and our milk is dairy. So that actually, that logic doesn't hold up. We still have to deal with our honeybees, which we'll come back to in a little bit. Let's switch to the next slide. Okay, equipment. I should switch this slide when I do this demonstration for non-beekeepers. I was looking for an example of where you would actually be liquefying honey. This is a huge problem that people don't know. People say, can I go over to a beekeeper and buy honey from them? And I said to them, I've got to tell you a story. When I first started keeping bees, I have a lot of goldenrod honey upstate in New York. Goldenrod honey, you look at it too hard, it crystallizes. And so I was forever liquefying the honey, and I put a whole bunch of it into bottles. And the bottles, again, sat out for a week, 2 weeks, it would recrystallize. What did I do? It was early on, I wasn't as advanced. I put it on my stovetop, put it on a low flame, in a double boiler, and I cook it like that. Well, here's the kosher law. If that pot was non-kosher, came from a non-kosher house, the average beekeeper doesn't necessarily keep kosher. If he brings it inside his house, he takes that jar, he puts that jar in the water, turns it on, and here's the magic number, 120 degrees, right around where I set my sous vide to re-liquefy honey now. 120 degrees is considered the transfer of non-kosher. So if I have a non-kosher pot, water, which is neutral, that's going to be a parm ingredient, kosher by nature. My honey, which started out, let's assume, kosher, that honey becomes non-kosher. which we'll get back to. Go on to the next one. But then 120, I can put it down on the bottom. Okay. Similarly, this is another thing which most, a lot of people don't know, and I'll give you an example. I actually went to visit a very good friend of mine who's a beekeeper. I actually certify his honey. And when I went to certify him, I went to visit him, and he had a whole bunch of these, he's in Canada, he has a whole bunch of these 55-gallon drums. Now, him, like most beekeepers, were often short on cash. He wasn't going to go buy new drums. He went out, and there are a whole bunch of places that recondition drums, they clean them out. Yeah, and he bought these very nice 55-gallon drums that had been used for something else prior to that. Vegetable oil. Vegetable oil, the very overlaying companies that they are. Vegetable oil is a very kosher sensitive ingredient. Well, he put his honey into that, those vats. They sat there for more than 24 hours. Even with the absence of heat, if I put something into a non-kosher vessel and I leave it there for 24 hours, which we'll talk about how you solve that problem, the product inside becomes non-kosher. So I said, I got to prepare loosely. All your honey is non-kosher. Even if you started out kosher, because you put them into these vats, and these vats are non-kosher, you made all your honey non-kosher. Let's go over to our next one. Okay, so how do we deal with that? We actually kosherize the equipment. It's one of the dangerous things we do as rabbis. I tell my rabbi, the people who work for me, I don't do much of this myself. I do a lot of supervision, and these guys that you see there are people that actually often work for me. I used to do this as a kid. Unfortunately, I never got seriously burned. But we're dealing with boiling hot water. The equipment has to be purged and clean. And the idea is that any foreign debris that's on the equipment has to be removed prior to using it. And this process is called kosherization. We're hopeful that you have to do it once. Generally, when we start with a new company, we kosherize the equipment. We're not starting with new equipment. We kosherize the equipment, bring it back to a kosher par state if they're making par. And it hopefully stays that way. Because if you keep kosher product on top of kosher product, it will obviously not affect the status of the equipment. You can go to the next slide. Okay. Different kosher symbols. There are lots of them. Now, a company or a person who's honey producer decides they want to become kosher. There are a lot of different agencies. I'm not the only one giving kosher certification. You see my symbol, of course, I put it on the center right in the middle. But there are a lot of agencies. It started out when my dad started the business, there were five, now there's probably 500. There are a lot of local rabbinic groups that have started giving certification, and it's somewhat confusing. So if you hit the next slide, you just get as an example. That's some, keep going. That's, again, probably about a tenth of it. Can you guess which symbol's mine?
Yeah.
Front and center. Here's UMK, that's up in Midwest Kosher. Here's a company out in Israel. There's Baltimore. KBH is in Boston. California, Canada, Philadelphia. I got to think about it myself. Manhattan. There are very often regional kosher agencies, and there are also national kosher agencies. And then there are some kosher agencies which are just not necessarily, as more people know who they are. What difference does it make? What do you care? Kosher is kosher. So in answering it, that's really the wrong thing to tell a beekeeper, because it's honey?
No.
Absolutely not. You get the Chinese honey, you know that it's mostly sugar water that the bees drew down. Mm-hmm. Similarly, not every kosher agency necessarily has the same standards. So we may want, because we're going to talk about perhaps another alternative, but what we may want, if you're looking for a kosher agency, you probably want a kosher agency which is going to be recognized, that the average person is going to trust, the average kosher consumer is going to say, this is an agency that's got the reputation that they're going to take care of the kosher requirements, and that they're trustworthy enough that what they're saying is true is in fact true. You can go over to the next slide. Okay, so how do we take care of kosher? One of the main things we do is we do audits of our company. Rabbi comes to visit the facility, he checks out all the ingredients. Honey doesn't have any ingredients, but all of it, except for now. I didn't know that, by the way. Thanks for that piece of information. Imported honey is not going to have to say sugar on the label. It's very interesting. I'm going to be the first one to enforce that. But we basically send the rabbi, and that rabbi visits the facility, depending on the type of facility, a few times a year, as often as we have facilities that have rabbis in the facility the entire time. And his job job is to verify that they're meeting with the kosher club requirements. Why would I have a rabbi there more often or less often? It depends on the complexity. If we have a facility that's doing kosher and non-kosher in the same facility, it would be an example of that. Yesterday, I visited a facility that is in the fish production industry. They want to produce on one side of their facility anchovy paste, and on the other side, shrimp portions. Now, shrimp portions are non-kosher. Anchovy paste, anchovies are kosher fish. However, there's a whole bunch of separation that's got to be maintained, and the only way they can even think about doing it is by having a rabbi in the facility. On the other hand, we certify ConAgra, which makes in their flour mills. All they do is grind wheat. Wheat is kosher by nature. All they're doing is grinding wheat. You don't have to go there more than once a year. There's really nothing to see. So the rabbi visits, and he basically is there to confirm that anything the companies agree to is actually being implemented. You can go to the next slide. Okay, and this is just a nice slide that my sister put on. We work together. I agree with it. Good to teamwork, we should network and work together. Okay, so now we're going to get right into the bees. So, the big problem that we're going to have, remember I spoke to you about the milk, and the milk is not necessary. However, there is a kosher law. Anything that exits a non-kosher animal is non-kosher. Which means if I have a pig and I milk a pig, that milk is non-kosher because pig's not kosher. Even though milk doesn't have the same status as the meat itself, anything that comes out of a pig is non-kosher. Horse, camel, whatever the case is. Shellac. There was a lot of discussion about shellac because shellac comes from the lac beetle. And different but similar process to honeybees. Somewhat different because it goes in one end, comes out the other, as opposed to the honeybee regurgitates. But this goes in one end, out the other. And the initial assumption was shellac should be non-kosher. Now, you're all probably looking at me, who in the world eats shellac? You all do it. It goes on chocolate. It's the glaze on the resinous glaze that goes on top of chocolate. Don't eat shiny chocolate after this. But it actually, so bees should not be kosher. If we look at it, we think about it, bees are not kosher. Bees are not kosher, and therefore honey should not be kosher. And the common answer is, wait a second, Israel is a land flowing with milk and honey. Yeah. The story, right? Let's close the book. Well, that's actually completely wrong. Because as much as I like to promote that, it's the land flowing with milk and honey, and everybody should buy honey, it's not talking about honey. Well, it is talking about their honey, not our honey. Date honey is correct. Yeah, not very smooth. They were talking about date honey, which, by the way, is horrible. I tried to play with it. I tried to even make beer with it. I couldn't do much with date honey. But they were talking about Dvash Tamarin, which is, Dvash Devorin, which is honeybee honey, was very, very rare, considered a tremendous delicacy. There were managed hives in biblical times. There's actually a lot, I collect the incidents where it's recorded in the Talmud. There's a lot of Talmudic discussion about how do you manage a bee colony during the winter. How many, you can cut out a certain amount of combs, and they obviously have skeps. How many you have to leave? It's very interesting. Talking about Israel, it's a different climate. They came out, there's a debate between the rabbis. I thought this was fascinating. Whether you have to leave 3 comb or 6 comb to survive winter. They're not beekeepers. They were talking beekeepers. And then they said, well, what happens if I want to take more? Are you allowed to? What would be the problem? The problem was it's something called batashas. We're not going to waste it. So if I'm going to take more, if I'm going to steal more honey than the bees need, and then my hive is going to collapse, there was Talmudic authorities who felt that you were actually committing a crime. Okay, let's go over to our next slide. Okay, so this comes in, yes, why? Let's turn to the next slide because I don't know how I made this up. Okay, so the answer is the Talmud talks about this. One of their questions, should honey be kosher? So, the first answer they said, well, maybe it's because of the fact that we see that there are references, not the land of milk and honey, but there are other biblical references to honey. And they said, well, that can't be the answer. And then they said, wait, honeybees, and this was used for the lac beetle. There's a famous rabbi, Moshe Feinstein. He lived, he died in the 60s. He came to the United States early 1900s, and he was considered a big authority. garden and he doubled the volume. Modern questions. And he used our honeybee to actually say that that shellac should be permissible. And basically what he said is the bees are not producing honey. And by the way, think about your other hive products, because this is going to affect our other hive products. Bees are not producing honey. What bees actually do is they are collecting nectar, they add an enzyme to it to convert the sugars, and then they deposit it into the cells, into the wax cells. Amazing how much they knew. This is 2,500 years ago. Amazing how much they knew. Where they basically said, it's not a question, again, I threw in, that's really a misquote, it's not land, milk, and honey, it's other passages. But basically, the first answer, which is the second answer that the Talmud wrote, is the primary answer to why honey is kosher. Honey is kosher because even though the bees collect nectar, they are doing a minimal amount of processing, and that was very important to Rabbi Feinstein for the black beetle. They're processing it, but they're minimally processing it. So, what this leaves us with, so now honey is kosher. But I have to ask you about two questions. Does anybody here know what forest honey is? Forest honey is collected, and by the way, everybody here in this room has forest honey in their hives. When we go through the dark of summer, our bees look to collect something from actually what the aphid nectar. There's a small bug called an aphid, and the aphid sits on plants and produces these little droplets of sweet liquid. And actually, our bees will collect very, very little in our area, but our bees will actually collect that and bring that back to the hive. So, but there is something very sought after called forest honey. It's very expensive. Forest honey may not be kosher because the bees collect that exclusively from aphids. They change it. It sounds better than aphid honey, so they call it forest honey. But it is collected by honeybees, and they collect it from a sugar source other than true nectar. And I actually wrote in when we were discussing this is a modern question, I actually wrote into the American Bee Journal and got a response. It said, the first time I'm answering a rabbi, I felt so proud. the verdict isn't out as to whether or not to consider it kosher or not. There's debates now amongst the rabbinic authorities as to how to consider that. Rabbi Feinstein permitted shellac based on the honeybee. Honey, we consider kosher. How about wax? So, if you know anything about honeybees produce wax. Wax is not a good. Our propolis is going to not be a problem because propolis is processed even less, although it's a problem for you. I have a problem with one colony that doesn't. I have five colonies in Teaneck, in my backyard in Teaneck, one colony, which is a rescue, propolizes everything. Eventually, they're going to propolize the bottom entries. But propolis is not a problem. I don't collect propolis. Way too much work. I put it in the freezer. It's not for me. But propolis should be kosher. Also, wax should not be kosher, right? Wax is kosher, by the way. If you guess that, you will absolutely win the prize. Why is wax kosher? So the Talmud talks about that. Why would wax be kosher? Wax is kosher because it's considered just a carrying agent for the honey. It is considered what they call tuffle, it's considered insignificant, where people, if you think about the way people cut comb and comb honey, you're really buying the honey. The wax is basically absorbing the flavors from the honey, and they consider it as an insignificant part. The other thing which is actually not kosher, according to just about all kosher authorities, is royal jelly. The royal jelly, which is also produced from a gland by the honeybee, is not kosher, but fortunately our honey is kosher. Let's go over to the next slide. So now we get back to small-scale beekeepers. I sort of covered this right now. Excellent. Small-scale beekeepers and crystallized honey we sort of talked about. It's a big, huge problem, something we have to be sensitive to, especially if you end up non-certified and somebody comes to you and asks you, you should be honest with them and say, yes, the honey was started out kosher, but it did crystallize and I warmed it up in my kitchen. If you do that, if you don't have a warming tank, you go over to the next slide. Okay, we covered this already. I hope I did a good job. Beeswax and propolis, pollen. Pollen kosher, you guys should be able to answer this yourself. So this one, you can sort of work it both ways, because pollen actually has bee saliva in it. That's how they solidify it. They actually chew it a little bit, put it on their back legs, and carry it back home. right? But it's actually, again, it's considered an insignificant amount, and saliva, believe it or not, is not something that they felt would get any positive value to the pollen, so they basically viewed it as just a product collected from flowers. So pollen is kosher also. I don't sell pollen anymore because, according to Tim Schuler, that's because he actually did a study, my hives were included in that. Pesticides are not really stable in honey, but they're very stable in pollen. So I've actually stopped selling pollen, but they're unrelated to this. But okay, there are hive products that's going to the next screen. And I'm the only beekeeper that I know of in the kosher industry. There's probably one in Israel that I don't know about. And it's a picture of me from a magazine. And of course, so let me leave you with the following. How does one become kosher if they're a beekeeper? So the truth is it's very difficult for the following reason. If I ended up certifying most of these small operations, my costs, I don't go out myself, I work in an office, my cost of sending a rabbi, even if I'm only going to come visit you four times a year, is probably going to be more than a small-scale beekeeper produces. So let me tell you a little bit about Jersey law. There is nothing that says that I can't say my honey is kosher, as long as you meet the basic requirements. So people call me up all the time. Can I buy honey from a beekeeper? I met a beekeeper in a farmer's market. I'd love to buy that honey. Can I buy that honey? Is the honey kosher? So let's ask ourselves a question. The honey itself, if you believe the beekeeper, you got a much better chance with a local beekeeper than you do with a beekeeper from China. If you believe the beekeeper that it's really honey, honey is kosher by nature. What's your only problem? The equipment that it was stored in. So I tell them, ask them the following question. Do they have a honey house? If they have a honey house, and is that honey house used exclusively for producing honey? If the answer is yes to both of those questions, you're pretty safe. If not, here's the problem. Unfortunately, I know I'm sitting in a room with beekeepers. Beekeepers are not always honest about crystallizing the heating honey. And if they are if they're truthful, and we should all be truthful, if they're truthful, and at times, you know, sometimes I get in a rush and I do heat my honey up and I thought, well, it's not raw. My criteria for raw is 120. I think I actually go up to 160. For kosher, it's 120. The best way, I don't know, now it's starting to become popular, best way, buy yourself a sous vide for 160, for about 60 bucks. Put it in, set the sous vide for 120, walk away, come back tomorrow morning, honey will be beautifully liquefied, and still kosher. If you go to 110. If you go above that number, not wrong with it, it just may not be kosher, unless the the sous vide and the immersion tank that you only use for honey, or whatever else. If you have 5 gallon buckets that you heat with one of those band heaters, by the way, don't call it raw, because it will heat up to like 160. I've tested it. But it will still be kosher. So you're allowed to, can you put it on the label? Depends on the state. New Jersey says no, believe it or not. New Jersey says by putting the word kosher on the label, you're saying it's inspected. However, you can certainly put in your literature that, and on your farm stamp, we do not process our honey. Our honey is considered kosher because we do not process it. It's kosher. It's a product that's kosher by nature, and it's never heated above 110 degrees. Or this honey that I'm selling you is never heated above 110 degrees. Honey, if you add any flavorings to, Mike's Hot Honey is a popular item. They're actually working very hard on trying to make that kosher. It's not currently kosher because the jalapenos they put in there are lined in vinegar. That's not kosher. We're not certified. So any ingredient you put there, if you make creamed honey, make sure the ingredient either don't add any ingredients to your creamed honey, or if you decide to flavor your honeys, those should not be sold as kosher. If you want kosher certification, sometimes you don't have the option of going with a national certifying agency. There could be, just like there's a local bee club, it could be that there's a local rabbinic agency who it could be much more economical for him to visit you. That's perhaps a possibility. The other thing, there have been clubs, there have been groups that have come to me and said, we want to do a certify our one extraction. We're going to alter, they very often get together anyway because you're sharing an extractor. We do a one-time event, bottle up right before Jewish New Year's is when we Jews were buying. And you should know that number, the 5 billion pounds of honey, half of it was sold before Jewish New Year's. But you certainly could work out some sort of co-op. And I am obviously would like to be a resource for all the beekeepers out there, you certainly can call me. I certainly try to give you guidance and help you any way I can. And thank you all for listening. I'll be here after the break. I'll probably stay here for the whole thing. Go join the audience. Thank you all for listening. I'd be happy to answer any questions that anybody.
Thank you.